It's my honor to introduce our two speakers today, Ms. Francine Denerstein and Mr. David Spitzman. Born in Germany in Bergen-Belsen, a displaced persons camp in 1948, Ms. Denerstein has shared her story of growing up as the child of Holocaust survivors to multiple audiences, including middle and high school students through the Rhode Island Holocaust Center. Her compelling reiteration of life as an immigrant is told on the backdrop of her parents' experiences as Holocaust survivors. As the mother of four and grandmother of eight, she continues to keep her solemn obligation to bear witness and honor her parents' memories by keeping her promise to never be silent again. Ms. Denerstein retired from a 30-year career working higher education as the Dean of the School of Professional and Continual Studies, focusing on non-traditional students earning their undergraduate and graduate degrees. She holds a bachelor's degree from Bryant University and a master's from Wesley University. Ms. Denerstein is here with her brother, Mr. David Spitzman. Mr. Spitzman is a member of the Rhode Island Holocaust Museum in Providence and the National Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. He was invited by President Clinton to the opening ceremony. For the past 40 years, he has been a supporter of the Southern Poverty Law Center, which tracks hate crimes and anti-Semitism. He's a member of the Southern New England Holocaust Memorial in Boston and was nominated to be on the board of the National Holocaust Museum Council by the late Rhode Island Senator Claiborne Pell. Mr. Spitzman's daughters, Shayna and Emily, graduated from St. George's in 1998 and 2000. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Ms. Denerstein and Mr. Spitzman.
Thank you very much for inviting us to your great school. Spent a lot of time in this chapel over the years with the girls. And we are here as representatives of the Rhode Island Holocaust Museum in Providence. We'd like to thank them for organizing this. Also, I'd like to thank your chaplain, Kirby, for organizing this as well. So, of course, I'm David. This is Francine. We're second-generation Holocaust survivors. That means that our parents are survivors of the Holocaust. We speak in schools and to civic groups to share our family's history and story and to share our understanding of what took place and why it happened. We are sending out a message to all of you and hope you will listen as to what can happen again if people go down a particular path. We speak for those that perished that cannot speak. Before we start, I would appreciate it if we could all take a moment of silence for those that have perished and for those in the Ukraine that are suffering today. So if that's okay, I'd appreciate it if we just close our eyes for a minute and just take a moment of silence. My parents were from Poland and Lithuania, both which border on Russia. Today we'll touch upon a very small portion of their story. Our family story is a very, very long story. My parents lost most of their families in the Holocaust. My mom was the only surviving member of her whole family. The fact that my parents survived is a miracle, considering the horror they went through and witnessed. I think they were living proof that the human spirit is indestructible. The Nazis certainly tried and failed to destroy their spirit. After the war, their survival, they were allowed to come to America, not knowing the language, no money, no relatives, not knowing their future, only knowing they were free and coming to start a new life with my sister, who was 9 months old at the time, upon their arrival in 1949. Hitler came to power in 1933. I'm sure a lot of you know a lot of this history, as Chancellor of Germany. The German economy after World War I was in shambles. And Hitler came and promised that he would revive and revitalize the economy of Germany. He said he would make Germany great again. People believed him and believed in him. and stop thinking for themselves. Hitler had an incredible ability to mesmerize people with his speaking and to get people to think the way he thought, as opposed to people thinking for themselves. The masses followed him. Hitler was an open racist and anti-Semite. He hated Jews and proclaimed Germans were the master race and all others were less than that. Anti-Semitism, hatred against the Jews, spread like wildfire, like a cancer of the soul. People needed a scapegoat, and the Germans and other minorities were it. The cancer of the soul destroys empathy and all caring and compassion, and turns people into monsters capable of the atrocities that took place and that we are still seeing today in the Ukraine and in some cases in other parts of the world. Some of the decrees that Hitler issued upon coming into power were: Jewish children were not allowed to go to German schools. All Jewish businesses were boycotted by Germans. Jews were put on curfew and restrictions and could not travel and could not go anywhere freely. Jewish doctors, lawyers, teachers, professionals, common people that worked regular jobs were limited to practice, and the positions were eliminated. Passports and documents were stamped with the word Jew, Juden in German, in their passports so they could be identified as being Jewish. No public office could be held by a Jew anywhere in Germany. Then, if things were not bad enough, they went from bad to worse, to the unimaginable. In 1938, you probably all heard of this, there was an episode that took place in Germany. It was called Kristallnacht. That's in German, the night of broken glass. What happened was Jewish shops were destroyed and burned throughout Germany. Synagogues, houses of worship were burned to the ground, all while the authorities and the police stood by and watched while all of this was going on. Jews were regularly brutalized and not given any services, for example, medical, legal, or anything they needed. They were shunned from German society simply because they were Jewish. Jews were in a state of shock. How could this possibly happen in one of the most sophisticated, developed countries in Europe at the time? Jews were so integrated into the society that they couldn't even imagine that they would be ostracized the way they were and targeted the way they were. They were all part of German culture, but that's not what happened. Jews were in a state of shock, and this was just the beginning of the unimaginable nightmare to come, to be implemented, part of the master plan, the final solution. German, near over everything. Deutschland über alles, as you would say in German. I don't really speak German, but I try to make believe that I do. Anyway, a little bit of lightheartedness there. So Hitler's plan was to exterminate all the Jews, and he had a lot of help. The evolution of how this happened, the Holocaust could not have happened without the cooperation of the people. Not just the Germans, but people in many other countries where Jews were rounded up and persecuted and eventually deported or executed. They certainly cooperated with the German decrees and mandates. Murders and atrocities became acceptable practices, and any guidelines for human decency disappeared. In Germany in particular, people believed Hitler when he declared that he would make Germany a better place, that he would make Germany, as I said before, great again. Now, the Jewish people, they were defenseless. They were in a state of denial. They couldn't believe, even though all these decrees were taking place and that the night of broken glass took place. They just didn't believe that anything worse could possibly happen. Well, worse did happen. Jews were rounded up. They were put into ghettos. My mother was in the Vilna ghetto, Vilna was the capital of Lithuania, and she spent quite a bit of time there before she was eventually deported to one of the concentration camps. She was in several concentration camps, and I think my sister and I consider it a miracle that my mother lived and my father lived, to say the least. So, going off script a little bit here, so what Hitler utilized was brainwashing, getting people to think what he wanted them to think and to follow him the way he wanted them to follow and to do what he wanted them to do. That's why one of the messages that I want to convey this morning to all of you as young people is to not give up the most precious thing you have, which is your ability to think and your ability to not follow. Don't be a follower. Be somebody that, you know, listens to what you think is the right thing to do. And I think that I have a few other things to say, but I think at this point I'm going to turn it over to my sister.
Good. So thank you. It's a privilege to be here this morning, especially with all of you and my brother. And I'm going to take you a little deeper into the story of my parents' survival, their immigration, and our lives in Rhode Island. But the most important thing I can do first is introduce myself. My name is Froma, and in Yiddish that means holy. I'm actually named for my mother's mother, and I'm the daughter of Meyer and Rachel Spitzman, both of whom are Holocaust survivors, as David told you. I am their firstborn child. I was born in 1948. I was born in Bergen-Belsen, and that's located in northern Germany. Both my parents were liberated from concentration camps in Poland, and they were sent to Bergen-Belsen after the war. That became their home for about 4 years, and they shared that home with about 20,000 other survivors from Nazi death camps all over Europe. So sometimes I step back and I wonder, how did they survive? How did anybody survive? And why did the world remain so silent? So no matter how much I personally have learned about the Holocaust, I still find myself unable to comprehend the magnitude of these atrocities and the extreme to which humanity has gone. So each time I prepare for one of these presentations, I find myself filled with so many emotions about being the child of Holocaust survivors. So I've become a student, and I continue to learn as much as I can about the shadow that lived in our home. The shadow, like a whisper, whispered to me throughout my lifetime, and it weaved a tapestry of memories that continue to unfold. So let's go back to my parents meeting in Bergen-Belsen. They meet there, they find hope in each other. That hope fuels this fierce determination that they have and extraordinary courage because they waited 4 years to bring me to America. As David said, we land here in 1949, actually December 1949, in a foreign land. That was called New York. With the help of the United Jewish Appeal, we end up in Providence. My parents' emotional wounds were still very open and still very deep. And yet a year later, my brother David is born, and now we're a family of four. My dad, Meyer, was my hero. I never got tired of listening to all his stories of life before the war. His memories included a large family, cousins, aunts, uncles. It was such a sharp contrast to our family of four and how we lived. But as I look at my embracing the legacy of the Holocaust, it really was my mother's death and that grief that led me on a journey to embrace my incredible responsibility as a second generation. So as David told you, both of our parents were born in Poland, and that's where our families were for generations. That life was destroyed, and although my parents were committed to making a new home and a life, they were absolutely never free from memories, from nightmares, from post-traumatic stress, or from emotional wounds. First came their physical survival. They had to live. Then came the difficult journey of finding family or loved ones. Almost no one. But rebuilding the damaged trust took a lifetime, and their search for closure was virtually impossible, especially for my mother. My mother, as David told you, was the sole survivor of a family of five. 75% of all the survivors were sole survivors. She's the oldest of three children, grows up in Vilna. She's 17 years old when her life changes forever. And it changes because she and her mother go into hiding in a bunker. They are caught. My grandmother doesn't live, my mother does, and she's sent off to labor camps. My mother later learns, or David, you might have told me, that her father, my grandfather, and her two younger brothers die in the Pinar Forest. Mm-hmm. So I want to take you into just two stories about my mother that I'll share with you that are brief. So imagine a minute with me that you're 17 years old. You're all alone, and you have this knowledge that your family has been murdered. But you still have the courage, the resilience, and the strength to live. My mother learns that her cousin in another barracks is very, very ill, and she's absolutely in need of food. My mother steals a piece of bread. She gets out in the middle of the night, goes into the other barracks, and gives her cousin, Asha, the piece of bread. Well, Rachel is caught. And she's caught, and she's beaten by a woman SS officer, and she's left for dead. But Rachel survives. She wouldn't die. The second story that I'll share with you is after the war, and my mother is being transported with about 2,500 other survivors on a German warship called the Nazi Titanic. It was later called the Capricona. This ship accidentally gets bombed by the British government. And it, with the ship ablaze, with people all around her jumping to their deaths, my mother Rachel becomes one of 200 survivors that survives that, but she has no knowledge of how she survived. She arrives in Bergen-Belsen, sick, weak, and afraid, but she's alive. In contrast, we have my dad. He comes from this big family, lots of brothers and sisters, and he is actually brought up in the southern part of Poland, about 10 kilometers from Auschwitz. My dad serves in the Polish army, fighting the Nazis. Are you going to talk about this, Dave?
No.
No, okay.
He was on the front lines when the Nazis invaded Poland September 1st, 1939, and he was on horseback fighting the Nazis. Of course, they defeated Poland in 9 days, and he was wounded in that battle.
So what's amazing about my dad is my dad is wounded, and he's at the Russian border. Now, I told you how far he was from Auschwitz, which was hundreds and hundreds of miles, and he starts his journey back from Russia to his home. When he gets home, here's what he learns. This huge extended family that he has, most of them have gone to Auschwitz, and most of them died with the 1.1 million Jews that were in Auschwitz at the time. He does learn that he has a younger sister who's being held, who's being hidden by a Polish family. Her name was Rivka. Rivka must have been about 12.
You can say that picture that we passed around.
Yes, there's a picture being passed around of Rivka. So
it's the picture of my aunt, my father's sister, and she's got the Star of David on her chest. Well, Frank can tell you the rest of the story. Go ahead.
You know, what's so important about Rivka is there was this amazing Polish family that hid her till 1944. One day, you know, she goes out to just get a piece, to buy a loaf of bread. She's caught by the Nazis, she's killed, and the Polish family is killed. So that picture is pretty precious to us, and is actually in the Rhode Island Holocaust Museum, and David and I submitted that to the U.S. Holocaust in Washington,
D.C.
Let
me interject something.
Yep, sure.
So that picture that's going around, after the war, what happened was, you might wonder how we got that picture. My father went back to where he grew up, and he found out they actually didn't kill the lady in the family. They killed the husband and some of the others in the family, as well as my aunt. That picture, the lady that my father went back to see when he went back to find out if there was anybody left in his family, she had a tiny picture this big, and I had that picture done by a photographer. That picture is in the U.S. National Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
But so, that's the story about how we got the picture.
Yeah. So here's just one other story about my dad. You know, upon liberation, you know, the American and the British soldiers and the Russians come in and they say to the concentration camp inmates, "You're free." Well, you're free. Where are you going to go? How are we doing for time? Okay. You're free.
10 minutes. Okay.
My father had nowhere to go. So he goes back to his home in Sosnowitz, and he goes to the house that his grandfather and his father and he built, and he's met by a Polish family. And this Polish family says to him, and I quote, "This is not the Poland that was. This is not your home anymore." My dad has nowhere to go. He goes back to Bergen-Belsen. He works in a kitchen. He meets my mom. That's where they get married. And one thing David and I will always cherish is that my dad was an amazing storyteller. The piece that was so important about him is there was a message in every story that he told that was captivating. I want to bring you fast forward just a bit and tell you about what was life like for us in Rhode Island. Well, here's what I knew. I had a house that had enormous suffering in it, and I just couldn't comprehend it. But I absolutely knew that my home wasn't like the home of my friends. David and I spoke Yiddish. That was our first language. And we would always overhear our parents speaking with other Holocaust survivors about their experience. We didn't understand, but we knew clearly that something terrible had happened to them. As time passed, life continues, and while they're still mourning the past, both of my parents went to night school. They worked to become American citizens within the first 5 years of arrival. My dad was an absolutely exquisite fine furniture maker, and he continued to make furniture till he was 89 years old. When he passes away, my mother at 82, she's alone again, and she reluctantly moves into an assisted living center that becomes her home, where she was very cared for and loved. When my mother dies, my brother and I sat with her silently for a very, very long time, because a piece of us was gone forever, and now it was him and I. So I want to wrap this up by telling you that my parents did have a chance to rebuild their lives. And with the birth of each grandchild and great-grandchild, they began to beam. They forged this incredible bond with the third generation. And as our children sat close to their grandparents, listening to their stories, they loved them unconditionally. And yet, the shadow of the Holocaust has always been there in my life. It has always been a difficult responsibility for me to bear. I only wanted to be this American girl, not a refugee, not a greenhorn, and not an immigrant. And even as I married and had children of my own, there were so many unresolved issues and memories that I had. So I chose to begin my own journey and understand how the Holocaust impacted my own life. So who am I? I am Frumma, and I am and always will be the daughter of Holocaust survivors. I will bear witness to their lives, to their strength, and to their courage. So I want to take us just fast forward just a little bit more. This is where I'll end. It's been 7 decades since the end of the Holocaust, and there's been rallying cry for everybody to remember. But here's what the reality, that it took 30 years for anybody to want to listen. Nobody wanted to hear their stories. Nobody was interested in their suffering. But the world began to listen in 1970. Through movies, through books, through essays, through survivor testimonies, we began to understand more of what the power of one man could do. So I'm going to ask and kind of end with, if I could, I keep asking, man's inhumanity to man, it still continues. We see acts of discrimination, segregation, violence. How do we make sense, any of us, of what's happening in the Ukraine, what happened in Cambodia, what happened in Rwanda, and unfortunately what's happening here in America? So I'm going to leave you with a quote of from Elie Wiesel that touches my heart every time. The opposite of love is not hate, it's indifference. The opposite of indifference is not ugliness, it's indifference. The opposite of life is not death, it's indifference. We will never forget, and we are partly, and we are here to continue to share that story as part of our parents' legacy.
So one of the, Fran mentioned Elie Wiesel. I know we just have a few minutes left. I'll just add a few things. So Elie Wiesel was brought up an Orthodox Jew. I don't know how many of you have heard of his book Night or read it or heard of Elie Wiesel. Probably almost everybody here. So he was about maybe 11 years old when he was in Auschwitz, and he survived Auschwitz. And he grew up an Orthodox Jew. One of his biggest dilemmas, and I've read about quite a bit about Elie Wiesel, his biggest dilemma was, how could there possibly be a God? That was his biggest dilemma, that he would say, how could there possibly be a God, a merciful God, to allow the types of things that happen. Another thing with reference to our family history is that my father's sister, who did survive, they lived in Montreal, her husband and 4 siblings were all in Auschwitz. They all, you saw the pictures, they had tattoos on their arm. They all survived. It was like a miracle. They all survived Auschwitz. There was 5 siblings in that concentration camp. So the only thing I'd like to say to you all is that as you sit here and you've listened to my sister and I'd like you to just, I'm going to ask some questions. There won't be any answers, but it's just something for you to think about. Of course, how could this have happened? What makes people with their own mind allow themselves to be brainwashed? How could this happen to such a developed society, which we talked about? What are the root causes? Where does all the hate come from? We touched upon some of these things. We tried to answer some of the questions, but you know, even after studying this for decades, I still shake my head and don't know the answers. And the only thing I would ask of all of you is to be intolerant to racism and bigotry. When I say that, I mean, you know, if you're confronted with it, don't be afraid to say something. Say, you know, that's not right. Your thinking's off. Because those things, racism and bigotry, are the seeds That's the seed of how it all begins. When people start to have that in their hearts, and it's something that's very, very dangerous and can happen anywhere. We see it in our own country, you know, in America today. And it's more prevalent than ever. So please, you know, think about these things and pay attention to that. And keep asking questions and read about the Holocaust. And if any of your teachers or your students ever want my sister and I to come into your classroom and get into more detail, we'll be happy to do it. I feel like St. George's is a great place. And my kids got a wonderful education here. We met some of the nicest people. Thank you very much.